know that general ages are largely going to have in parental family. And so it's largely a result of the process of socialization. So it depends a lot how in each family an exponent is grown up and what was the situation in the family. But I argue that it's not only the family that matters, but also the society. And we can see a huge process of differences in general ages. So the question is, do parental characteristics play an equal role in different kinds of societies? So, and the objective of this research for this stage is to reveal the impact of parental characteristics in societies and low and high level of German knowledge. So, what about the theoretical framework? Yeah, I based the research in a peer of peer friendly period and the process of child caring and socialization could be regarded as the investment in different forms of human and social capital. Children from wealthier and more cultural families are more privileged and they are somehow in better positions than those who grew up in more poor families and less educated. But also this theoretical framework could be expanded to the societal level. So those individuals who grew up in countries more wealthy countries where gender roles gender rights were more respected are somehow in more privileged situations. So here to the partner perspective, we see some connections to the theoretical framework of growth in the father and to the extension of security. So we can see the high level of existential security in birthday countries, like you can see that it's how somehow also investment in the in respondents. Countries differ a lot in general, we know that countries differ a lot in general attitudes. It concerns both Europe and whole world. Well, it was shown that both individual education and parents' education have an impact upon general attitudes. Also, I was shown that parental religiosity, parental social status, and also socialization also differs by countries and it has an impact on general attitudes. What about country characteristics? And here I argue that in less affluent societies, less affluent societies, both value system and social structure are less stable. So like the process of brain transmission could be less smooth. So social transformations themselves, as it was mentioned before, can influence individual values and attitudes. So the main hypothesis is that the higher the gender inequality, the higher is the level of gender inequality in the country, that there is less impact on parental characteristics on individual gender or attitudes. Here is the main country level variable. I use gender inequality index. Why have children that index? Because on one hand, it represents the wealth and the wealth of the country. But on the other hand, it also represents, let's say, close to the gender equality. So it somehow combines both of these perspectives. And I use the recent data of the European Union study, but I use the gender inequality index for 1995, because you can see that it more represents the level of gender inequality in the country when the respondents were growing up. Here there is just the distribution of the gender inequality index country, you can see Georgia here, for instance, so the gender equality level is quite high, and in Scandinavian countries, gender inequality is rather low. So here is the main data methods. And so the main dependent variable that they use for this stage is that when jobs are scarce, much of the more active job than women. And when it's one, that means that the individual has greater general attitudes. And when it's zero, that means that the individual has traditional general attitudes. Independent variables for educational level of father and mother, and it's good that we have in this data set, we have educational level of both parents compared to, for instance, the last wave of European way of study. Second is the employment status of mother and father. And third is whether mother and father liked reading books. And fourth is whether they had problems of making ends meet. I also would like to mention here that this measure is somehow better than when parents had problems placing broken things, because it's more clear, it's better understood by the respondents. So, and here there are the main results. So, it's the individual level results. We can see that, of course, the high level of communication of mother and the high level of communication of father have positive impact on general attitudes. So, of course, giving parents a high education, more deleterious general attitudes. Concerning the working status, we can see that the working status of father didn't play any role. That would be easy to explain, because in most families, father still did some work at the time of 14. But the working status of mother played a role. So, for instance, in the families where mothers were self-employed or didn't work, the respondents who grew up in the families where the mothers were self-employed or didn't work, they have more traditional gender roles. Also, when parents have problems making ends meet, it leads to, in general, to more traditional gender attitudes. So the same here refers to the when mothers like to read mothers and fathers didn't like to read books. That means that the respondents have more traditional gender attitudes. But here, what is the most interesting story here is not the answer, the results, but are the interaction effects. For example, so we can see here the effect of mother's high education and mother's high education on the respondent. We can see, so here you can see, the left side, you can see the countries where the gender inequality index is low. So in general, you can see the gender egalitarian countries. So in that country, the relation is as expected. We see that the more, the higher the level of education, parents' education is, the more the gender attitudes of the individual are. But if you go to the countries with high level of gender inequality, you can see that the parental, in both parents and mothers' education, doesn't play any role anymore. The same tendency occurs for the father and mother didn't like reading books. So, for instance, in the countries where fathers and mothers did not like reading books, the respondents, these individuals have more traditional gender attitudes. But in the countries with high level of gender inequality, this doesn't have any role of gender attitudes. Also, if we can see that the wealth of the families, we can see that countries that, so there are two specifications of independent variable, where parents didn't have problems for making ends meet, that in gender egalitarian countries, individuals whose parents didn't have any problems with making ends meet, individuals with more egalitarian gender attitudes. But in the other countries with high level of can see that it doesn't play any role. And if they have the parents with legal problems making ends meet, you can see the same tendency that in countries where the level of gender inequality is high, these individuals have even more traditional general, they have more traditional general areas than those who have many problems making ends meet. The main findings are four. So we can see that the effect of parental characteristics really depends on countries with a low and high level of gender inequality. So in countries where the gender equality is gender inequality is low, gender egalitarian countries, so the effects is expected. So there the conception of Korea works, and the more the kind of Asian parents can say, whether the mother worked and their high material wealth the parents have, the more gender relatives the respondents have. But when we come to them, countries with high level of gender inequality, the situation is different because this parental characteristics either do not play any role or they play even the opposite role. So how we can explain this? Because for me it was quite a puzzling results. But also we can try this explain through the educational system. Because the general educational system in society is reproduces some basic roles and labels. And it means that in countries where the gender equality is prevalent, the educational system also transmits the values of gender equality. And it means that the higher education leads to more gender equilibrium. But when we go to, when we come to these countries where the prevalent, there is a high level of gender inequality, you can see the difference, there could be a different situation because the educational system itself can reproduce the values of gender inequality. This could be one of the possible explanations. And another explanation is that in more countries, the value of transmission is less smooth, and hence it means that the parents, there are other characteristics that play a great role in individual general attitudes than the characteristics of the family. So I will stop here and look forward to your questions.
Thank you, Bessem.
I suppose that you look at a very nice presentation. I don't want to say that. I suppose that you look into the difference between mother and father, relative direct effects, the effects of the education of mother, for instance, and the effect of the education of father. But tell us nothing about the difference in the disease. And considering the previous theory, which you consider that between the family, it's some negotiation, depending on the position of the student. I wonder if this affects somehow the position of the
student. Thank you. So I haven't done it yet,
but it's a good idea to develop the position of the mother and father, and actually combine some both of them, making both of them as the model somehow. I will do it.
Thank you.
Interesting presentation. Maybe I missed something, but why did you decide to use the level of gender inequality in 1995? Is it because it is closer to the generation of the parents?
Yes,
the
first idea was to use
a
gender inequality index for the current year,
okay.
But here we can face this problem of causality.
I understood correctly your attempt. I would suggest you to use another indicator of gender inequality, maybe less sophisticated than the gender employment index, but the female to male labor force participation rate is a good indicator of gender inequality, but it offers the advantage that we can link, because there are the data, are available, we can link the precise value for the generation of the parents or for the time when the respondents was raised by the parents.
Thank you. You mean that female labor force participation rate to male labor force participation rate?
Exactly.
So they can
account
both of them.
Exactly.
I have the same question for you.
Okay. So we can keep the question here following that.
I'm not sure whether the labor force participation of the female male would be such a good indicator. The labor force social status of a woman, not that they are something.
Yes.
But think of, for instance, wage pay gap, gender pay gap.
Yes, but then the data availability is not so high. I think for the.
Sorry, the gender wage gap is less available for previous waves, for previous years, because she should link data with the year of birth, more or less, to have an indication of when they were raised by their parents.
Other questions? Okay.
I was just wondering, earlier in the presentation you were discussing like how much of this is driven by family and how much is driven by society. And in the EVS questionnaire, we do identify second generation immigrants, right? Abuelos, boyos, and unborn, boyos, and otherborn. Is that, that's in the EVS questionnaire, right?
So, yes.
Yeah, so that would be an interesting subset of the respondents to look at because they're getting such different, likely many are getting such different messages at home versus outside the home. You might shed some light on that.
Other questions? Okay, thank you. And let's move.